you for coming tonight. I know there were many other exciting, wonderful things you could have been doing in Kingsville tonight. I know the kindergarten. Y'all need to just, like, get out of here. Kindergarten through second grade. Bye. I thought everybody left a while ago, so. They did they? You don't know. Who's the pastor here? Okay, that was three people. I don't know where everybody else went. They're all running around outside in the street, I guess. That's... Somebody amen, bro. You must not be a... No, he is a parent. Okay, all right, I understand. All right, kindergarten up to second grade, is that right? Okay. Thank you for coming tonight. It's really good to see you. I'm going to ask that you come back tomorrow night. And then there's that Tuesday thing going on. And then, straight up, Wednesday shows up. And I know some of you are thinking, oh, man, it's such a busy time. What's going on? Who scheduled this? Good to see you, Brother Jack. Here's what I know. Some of you are thinking, man, three more nights, I have to be up to church. What's that all about? And some of you are going to just drag up here and go through the motions. Or, you know what? You can come expecting refreshment from God. And how you look at something really determines what you think about it. Amen? I'm sure I've shared this story with you before. And, where's the brother with the broken leg? You keep moving on me. Well, quit moving around. Find a place and stay there. Little basketball accident, huh? Is that right? And I twisted my knee playing basketball last week. But about, I may have shared this with you before, about 6 years ago, I broke my right foot, and for 6 weeks I had to wear a boot cast. And the problem with boot cast is that you can't drive, but nobody told me that. And I drove with my right foot. I could either go 0 or 90. I couldn't find that in between. It was either nothing or all good, you know what I mean? And so for 6 weeks, my wife had to drive me everywhere I went. Now, my wife is a wonderful, great woman. You will love my... When you meet her, you will say, I like you so much better than him. I promise. But my wife is not a good driver, bless her heart. She's a bomb on wheels looking for a place to roll and blow. I came home a few years ago. She had that look on her face. I said, honey, what's the matter? She said, I scratched the fender on the car. And she said, do you want to see it? It's in the trunk. She scratched it off. She hit a deer last week. He was in the zoo. If that tells you anything at all. So, for 6 weeks, Betty drove me. Now, I live in Grand Saline. Grand Saline is a very small town. There's nothing going on in Grand Saline. And we'll talk about Grand Saline in just a little bit. It's about 70 miles east of Dallas. And we live in Grand Saline, Texas. Grand Saline's in the boonies. It's just the boonies. We live 8 miles out. We live in, like, the sub-boonies. We're so far out from our house, you have to go towards town to hunt. They're just... Okay, let me know. So I went to Brookshire's grocery store one afternoon, and I got my crutches in my boot cast, and I put the crutches in the back of the truck, and Betty drives us home. When we got to the house 8 miles later, one of my crutches was gone. I have no idea how that happened. I mean, they're aluminum. They do not catch air. Somehow or another, Betty managed to hit something that bumped us up and knocked out my crutches. And so I said, Betty, we got to go back to town and see if we can find that crutch. So halfway back to town, we found a rubber pad laying out the highway. Looked like a little filled up hot dog bun in the sun, you know? But somebody had taken my crutch. Now, why would you take one crutch? So this is Friday afternoon, about 4:30. We went back home. I called a friend of mine in Grand Saline who has extra crutches. Grand Saline's a dangerous place to live. We have extra crutches. You never know when a crutch emergency could break out, you know? So I called my friend. I said, Carter, we lost a crutch. Can you grab one from you? And he brought one over that afternoon, Friday afternoon. Sunday morning, I'm going to my home church in Grantsville. I don't get to be there very often, about four Sundays out of the year, so I'm just very excited. Had to take a few weeks off for the surgery to heal. And I'm walking after the service, I'm walking after the car, and my friend Doyle, who works for the railroad there in Grantsville, saw me on the crutches. And so he came out and helped me get in the car, and he put the crutches in the back seat, and he said, I've never been on crutches before. He said, how is that? Is it okay? I said, well, it's not great, but it's not bad. I said, I'm getting along with it pretty well. He looked at my crutches. He said, you know, funny thing, look at those crutches. He said, a couple days ago, we were out on that road where you live, and we had a train across the road. We were stopping traffic, and he said, the first car that came pulling up, sticking out of his grill, don't get ahead of me here, just sticking out of his grill was a crutch. I said, what? He said, yeah, funny thing. He said, it was right in the grill. He said, I tapped on the guy's windshield and said, sir, you have a crutch sticking out of the front of your car. I said, Doyle, what did he do? He said, well, he got out and saw the crutch, pulled it out. It had gone into the radiator. Smoke and steam just came boiling out and water just pouring. He said he put the crutch in the back seat of his car, backed up, turned around, and sped off the other direction. I said, Doyle, when was this? He said, oh, it's about 4:30 Friday afternoon. I said, man, you're not going to believe this. 4:30 Friday afternoon, I lost the crutch on that very road. Must have bounced and hit the pavement as I was passing that guy and went into his radiator. I said, man, I probably need to find that guy and fix his car. My friend Doyle said, I don't think you'll find that guy. I said, why is that a problem? He said, well, you just lost your crutch, but he thinks he ran over a handicapped guy. It's all on how you look at it. It kind of depends which side you're coming from, amen? You can look at this week as having to drag up here for three more services and go through the motions, or you can look at this week as having a wonderful time being refreshed by the presence of Christ in your life. I think B is a better prospect, amen? Amen. So we'll be looking for you tomorrow night. Bring somebody with you. You know, we fill up our church for funerals and weddings. Wouldn't it be great to do it just for worship of the Lord? Amen. I drive around town today. There's plenty of folks here to fill this building up. But they won't come for me. They have no idea who I am. But they'll come because you bring them. They'll come because a friend reached out to them and invited them to come. So you do that tomorrow. See who God might put in your way, in your path tomorrow to do that. Turn with me, please, if you would, to the book of 2 Samuel. The book of 2 Samuel. And I think we're going to look at chapter number 23. Here's the deal. My wife for Christmas last year bought me, I'm getting older and the glasses are just not working out as well. She bought me a giant print Bible. Now, no, it is not large print. It is giant print. Giants can read my Bible. You got one? Okay. But here's the, and I don't know if they did do this to you the same way. Here's the horrible thing they did. They did all the words in giant. Thank them. God bless them. They did all the numbers in tiny. So I can tell you what's going on. I'm just not for sure where it's taking place, all right? So I'll give you an approximate. You look around that area, you find words I'm reading, and that's where we are, okay? And I'm pretty sure it's chapter 23, and we're going to start in just a few minutes in verse number 8. Thank you so much for coming tonight. I live in a very small town of Grand Saline, Texas, and maybe you have some great memories of the town you were raised in. Maybe you were raised here, or maybe some other place, and you can go back to your childhood. My boys have some great memories of their childhood. And every time we get together, some of those memories come up. For instance, one of my greatest experiences, we went to Washington, D.C. when the boys were about 8 and 10 years of age. And I wanted to see all the monuments. I've been there many times in concerts and different things. And I just love that part of the country. And I don't agree with everything that's coming out of our government, but I love the monuments, the buildings. It's so wonderful. And so I took them up to see Washington, D.C. And we saw the stuff, the Jefferson Memorial, the Lincoln Memorial, the Washington Monument. We saw all that. We went to the cemetery. But one of the most fascinating things that we went to, and if you go, you must do this tour, we went to the FBI building.
Oh, my soul, you cannot believe how fascinating this tour is. For an old guy and two little boys who were 8 and 10, I was just amazed the whole time we were walking through it. They were telling us about all the criminals and the different ways people broke out of jail and all the... Oh, it was so cool. And we finally ended up in this great big room that had pictures all around. Pictures of criminals. And I guess this was the last room of the tour. And the reason I say that is... The lady who was giving us the tour, she was an FBI agent, and she said, these are the most wanted criminals by the FBI in the world. All of these guys are really bad guys. My little boy, Caleb, was 8 years old, and my little son, Joshua, was 10, and Josh is pretty sharp. He's looking at all the pictures, and his eyes were about this big around. And the lady could sense maybe there was a problem. She looked at my son, Joshua, and she said, but son, don't worry. One of these days, the FBI will capture all of these people. My son Joshua looked at her and said, why didn't you keep them when you took their picture? That was our last room for the tour. We were led out the side. I don't think anyone else went with us. So they have great memories from their childhood. And so if I were to tell you to go back to your childhood and think of something that really just brings a little joy, and you've got that moment or that thing that comes up to your mind. And for me, I'm going to tell you what it is. When I was a kid, one of my favorite things, and still when I walk down the grocery aisle today and see them, it still gets me. One of my favorite things was Hostess cupcakes. Hostess cupcakes. Chocolate on the outside, creamy white filling, little circles on the top. It's a wonderful, complete, total dessert. If it is not in heaven, I will be so heartbroken. My brother and I, when I was 8 years old, he was 15. We had gone to vacation Bible school one day, and my mom taught in Bible school, and we came home, and we had just learned this great story about sharing what we have with each other. And when we got home, under the little cake cover was one Hostess cupcake. I looked at him, he looked at me. Boom, we ran for the cupcake. And cupcake was flying all over the kitchen. Something was broken, not totally for sure what it was. I'm sure it was antique. Everything we had was antiques. My mother came in, and oh, here's the thing. It's not who did the worst crime, it's just who ran the slowest that got in trouble, all right? And my brother managed to get out the side door of the kitchen, and my mother had me trapped and cornered, and she yanked me up, and she slammed me down the counter. Now, you've heard, used to, we had it on the bracelet some years ago, WWJD, what would Jesus do? Long before that was popular, my mother was using it on us. And she used it every day. And I will never forget this day. She slammed me down the counter. She was so angry. She said, we have just spent 3 hours at vacation Bible school learning how to share. And then you come home, and God gives you an opportunity to put into practice what you've learned, and you messed it up right away. What would Jesus do? Here's where it went really wrong for me. I said, he would buy more cupcakes. Worst flipping I ever had in my life. To this day, when I see a Hostess cupcake, there's a twinge and an excitement all at once. But here's my great memory of the Hostess cupcake. Every afternoon after school, Monday through Thursday, because on Friday I had piano lessons. Monday through Thursday, my friend Gary Huff and I, we would get through with school and we would run down to Paul Tills grocery store. And it was one of those grocery stores on the highway that had great big louvered doors that you opened up, and it was an open air store. Maybe you remember those. I don't know. Maybe they don't have them down here. But with 16 feet on each side, big doors, and you just walked right in and bought what you wanted. And we would go down every day and we would get a Hostess cupcake. And you're going to want to write this down. A bag of regular Fritos, don't get the big honking dipping kind, it ain't the same. A Hostess cupcake and a bag of regular Fritos and an RC Cola. Now you take a bite of the cupcake, that moist, chocolatey deliciousness. Then you pop in a Frito, the corn flavor, the salt. Ah, it's delicious.
And when you wash all that down with an RC Cola, if you ever did that, you would never do drugs, I promise. That's all you would need. Childhood memories are pretty cool, huh? That's the Bible. The book of 2 Samuel.
These are the names of David's mighty men. Now,
stop right there.
David had an army. Whew, they were something. These guys were amazing. You cannot believe how talented and gifted in warfare his soldiers were. And with a multitude of people, but there was a specialty squad, the inner circle of about 30 men who were called David's mighty men, and they were exactly that. And their whole purpose in life was to guard their king. Nothing else was important. They were the Secret Service of King David. They were the FBI. They were the CIA. They knew everything that went on with him. And their purpose and main reason for being in existence was to keep their king safe. Let's read about him. Joseph the Sheba was the chief of the three. He raised his spear against 800 men whom he killed in one encounter. 800 guys!
Take that, Chuck Norris.
That's fine. Next to him was Eleazar. As one of the three mighty men, he was with David when they taunted the Philistines. They taunted the Philistines. They taunted. He was with David when they taunted the Philistines gathered at Pass Damon for battle. And then the men of Israel retreated, but he, Eleazar, stood his ground and struck down the Philistines till his hand grew tired and froze to his sword. The Lord brought about a great victory that day. The troops returned to Eleazar, but only to strip the dead. This one guy fought the entire Philistine army. One sword, and he was still fighting with it. His hand stuck to it. You ever hammered for about 3 days in a row? Next 4 days, you just go to shake hands with somebody, and your hand just clutches around that old hand. This guy was using a sword, man. He was really something. One of the mighty men. Look at verse 11. Next to him was Shema, son of Haji. When the Philistines banded together in a place where there was a field full of lentils. Now get this. This is a pea patch. Are you ready? They're the pea patch. Israel's troops fled from them. But Shema took his stand in the middle of the field. He defended it and struck the Philistines down, and the Lord brought about a great victory. This guy really loved peace. Had the entire army for peace. Wow. These are the mighty men of David. These are the top three. There were actually four who were kind of the upper echelon, but the 30, they were always around David. They were there to guard him, to watch him, to stand for him, to do whatever he needed done because they loved him. And I need to tell you about these guys. Anywhere else in life, they were misfits. When David first started to become king, and he fought with Saul so much, he just had so much problems. But these people gathered around David, and he called them to. They were misfits. Some of them should have gone to trial for crimes against the government. Some of them were sorry outcasts of the world. But David saw something special about them, and he gathered them around him. And they were some kind of force to be reckoned with. They were strong. They must have really worked out on whatever they worked out on. I'm not big into this working out thing. I'm having some problems with that. I'm on a diet right now. Actually, I'm on two diets. I find you just don't get enough food on one. And I've been on SlimFast for 6 years now, and I drink one with every meal. And they're really good at midnight with some blueberry. I'm going to start doing better. I know this is the only body I've got. I need to do better with it. I just have problems with it. I,
I made it around the gym four times last week. I'm very proud of that. And next week, you know, I'm gonna park and go in. But I just really, I'm not motivated for that kind of thing. Now, my wife, she decided we needed to get physically fit, and we had a new gym, 24/7 Fitness, open up in Canton, Texas, close to where we live. 24/7. Who can exercise that long? And so we went over to look at, and I don't know if you've been to a new gym lately, but oh my soul, there are so many machines that I have no idea what they even do. It's kind of scary because they're all chrome and they're all moving, and it's just frightening. It's just a glare when you walk in. And so there was a trainer that was talking to Betty and showing her some of the machines, and I'm looking around all this stuff. I'll never figure this out. So I thought, well, I'm going to try something out just while I'm here. So I got into a machine, and I'm pushing stuff and moving things around. And the guy came over, and he said, "Sir, can I help you?" I said, "No, I'm fine." He said, "Well, you're really not. You're in the coat rack." So we've gone back several times, but I'm really having to struggle with these guys. I don't know what they did to work out, but they were something. They were dedicated. You know what? They were devoted to their tasks. So you can't find where I'm struggling these days and times. I'm having trouble finding men who are devoted to the task that God has called them to. I'm finding men who are having trouble actually going the full distance for the Lord. We just want to kind of sit in the background, and this is what I discovered. You know, we as men, we're pretty much comfortable when the women take a lead at church. I mean, you know, well, they're out there all the time anyway. They know what's going on. We'll let them do it. You know what I find? You know, if I were to turn a man-eating tiger loose in most Baptist churches, he'd starve to death. Where are the mighty men of God right now? Where are they when we need them so desperately to stand up? If you look at our world, it pretty much is falling apart, it seems. And I believe one of the reasons that we're having so much division in our nation is because we have a lot of God's men who just never stood up for what they believe in. We want to kind of fit in. We don't want to cause a wave. I'm so glad that Jesus caused a wave, aren't you? And these guys, they just loved King David so much. They took a stand for him, and they backed him up regardless. And was David always right? Oh, no, he was not. And they knew that about him, but they still loved him. I want you to see this amazing story. I just love this. During harvest time, three of the 30 men came down to David at the cave of Adullam, while the band of Philistines was encamped in the valley of Rephaim. At that time, David was in the stronghold. Now, let me explain this to you. David is not a young man at this time. He's an old man. As a matter of fact, this is one of the last times you hear from David. He's about to pass away. And they would no longer, the mighty men, no longer let him go into battle. They fought his battles for him. He stayed in what's called the stronghold. And he was put in the middle of the mighty men, and they surrounded him. And to get to him, you had to go through 30 of the meanest guys you've ever encountered. It was not going to happen. So David is in the stronghold in a cave. One of his last battles. And David longed for water, and he said, "Oh, I want you to hear this. Oh, that someone would get me a drink of water from the well near the gate of Bethlehem." You know what I believe? I believe he was having one of those remembering moments. Oh, man. Man, I remember when I was a kid. We got that water, and it was the sweetest, purest water. Oh, that water was so good. Oh, how I would love to have a drink of that water. He didn't bring anybody to get it. He didn't say, "Hey, somebody go down and get me some water." He just said, "Oh, that someone would do that. How sweet would that be?" Well, check this out, ladies. This is really good. I would love to see this in a movie. So the three mighty men broke through the Philistine lines. Now, are you paying attention to what's going on here? We have an entire Philistine army guarding Bethlehem. And the three mighty men heard that David wanted a drink of water from the well. What'd they do? "Well, guess we better go to the well, boys." They burst through the army of the Philistines. They drew water from the well. How long does that take? One guy's got to be drawn. The other two got to be watching. Something serious is going on here. They drew water from the well,
and they carried it back to David. He refused to drink it. Instead, he poured it out before the Lord. Far be it from me, O Lord, to do this. He said, is it not the blood of men who went at the risk of their lives? And David would not drink it. But how wonderful was it that someone loved him enough to go after that water for him? David's mighty men. They stood up for him regardless. Close your Bibles with me. I've been in ministry for many years now. Someone asked, well, when were you born? Well, in 1900, none of your business. My first church, and I'll not tell you where it was because someone here knows someone halfway there who knows someone all the way there. My first church was a very hard and difficult church. I'm going to be honest with you. I'm going to tell you what it was. It was a mean church. People there were just mean, not just to me, but to each other. It was a very mean church. You don't know those things until you get there. My first week there, I had a choir of about 65 people, and it was summertime, August, and we wore robes in those days. Didn't matter what time of year it was, you know, choir was supposed to wear robes, and we wore robes down. They were wool robes. I mean, you sweat in a wool robe for an hour and 10 minutes on an August day. You smell like a sheep. I mean, a dirty, wet, stinking sheep. And they would bring those robes back to the choir room, and we had this big closet area open that was there. And we had to go in there and open up doors and windows. And the next day, it was just horrible. Well, some older fellow in the church who worked with wood, he was trying to do a few things around the church. He was a sweet guy. Don't misunderstand me. He decided the choir robe closet needed doors. I'm going to tell you, the last thing we needed was to close that stuff up in there and let it breed by itself. You know what I mean? And I came in on a Thursday, and there were doors over the choir, and I opened up the doors, and it smelled like a fungus among us. I mean, I have never smelled anything so horrible. I thought, oh, who put these doors up? And nobody seemed to know, but don't they look nice? Yeah, they look great, but they're a hindrance to our health. So every Sunday morning when the choir got through and hung up their robes, I opened up the doors. And every Monday morning when I came in, the doors were closed. And so I'd open them up. And then Tuesday morning, the doors were closed. I'd open up Wednesday morning, the doors were closed. It got to be a crazy game, and I couldn't find out who did it. And so finally, I just went to the pastor. I said, we need to keep those doors open. He said, well, Mr. So-and-so, we'll call him Mr. Morrison. Yeah, that's what we'll call him, Mr. Morrison. Mr. Morrison built those closet doors, and he thinks they need to be closed. I said, have you been in there? He said, yeah, it smells horrible. I said, there's the deal. The following Sunday, we had our choir, hung the robes up, opened up the doors. When I came in Monday morning, they were closed with a lock on them. Now, you need to know my temperament. I'm pretty flexible for a period of time. And then, I don't know, I was young and took the locks off, but I also took the doors off and hid them in a place where they still haven't found them yet. When I did, Mr. Morrison, yeah, let's call him Mr. Morrison. Mr. Morrison went to the deacons and said, we need to fire this boy because he stepped way out of bounds. And they said, well, you know, he didn't really want the door. I put those doors up. I paid money for those doors, and those doors need to be closed every day. What good are they if they're not closed? Which is exactly my thought. What good are they, period? He wanted me fired. 3 months later, we take our ski trip to Glorieta, New Mexico. Our bus driver, let's call him Pete. Yeah, we'll call him Pete. Pete's driving the bus. Pete is a deacon, but he's a hothead. No offense to you deacons, but you know some of you may very possibly be a hothead. Pete was a hothead. He didn't like anybody to dust him. We're driving in our old church bus up the hill to Glorieta, New Mexico, and a brand new church bus from Arlington passed us like we were sitting still. I've never seen anybody so mad in my life. Pete was so angry. Why would they pass us on a road light? I said, well, they had a passing. Yeah, but they knew we were struggling. Why would they zip past us like they're making fun? It just went on and on. I said, Pete, calm down. Just the bus. We finally got to the slopes.
parked right beside that bus from Arlington, Texas. We went and skied the whole day. We came back. We had a wonderful time. But I noticed there was a crowd around the Arlington bus. Stuck my head in all four tires, and the back was slit. Two tires had all the air let out of them. Pete's sitting in the driver's seat of our bus. I said, "Do you know something about this?" "No. I've been skiing all day long." I said, "Pete, did you do this?" "Well, all I can say is I bet they don't beat us down the mountain this time." And he closed his knife that he had in his hand and put it in his pocket. So I came home. I went to the pastor. I said, "Hey, something needs to be done." But you know what? Sometimes it's the first guy who gets there who makes the most noise. Pete went to the deacons right away and said, "This boy doesn't understand anything. We need to get rid of him. Let's get him out of here. Fire his hide right now." So now all of a sudden, it's my neck on the block. I wanted Pete to apologize. I wanted our church to buy new tires for their church. That would have been the right thing. I don't care what age you are, that would have been the right thing to do. Somehow or another, it ended up my fault. And then, a few months later, we had our spring revival. Yeah. We had a preacher coming in, and he's a great preacher, and I wanted all the college students in that particular town to hear him, and I wanted them to come at lunch because they're so busy during the night. I wanted to have a great meal at lunch, so I went to the lady who's in charge of our food there, and I said, "We'll call her Gloria." "Yeah, that's her name. Gloria." I said, "Gloria, we got Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. We're going to have college meals every day at noon, and I'd like to have a really great meal." I said, "Monday, I want us to have burgers. And then Tuesday, I want us to have some kind of a really good soup. And then Wednesday, we're going to have some guys come, and they're going to cook steaks for us out on the grill." And she said, "That's an awful big expense for a bunch of college students." She said, "They don't contribute to our church at all." I said, "What do you mean?" She said, "They just come in here and suck up all the money, and they don't bring any money with them, and we're always pandering to them." I said, "We're trying to reach them for Jesus. And besides that, when they leave here, they go out into the mission field, and we have some part in their life. What's wrong with you?" She said, "I think it's a waste of money. They'll have salad every day." Well, you know, I got the church credit card, and I went down and bought burgers. I bought some really great soup, and I got some steaks for Wednesday. And she went to the deacons. Now, when I went to this church, I met with the committee. I met with the youth committee because they wanted me to do youth in college. I met with the music committee because they wanted me to do music. One of the deacons who was on the committee for the youth said to me, "What program do you plan on bringing to our church?" And I told him what I had in mind. "How are you going to implement this?" And I told him what I was thinking. And then he said, "Mr. Crain, what kind of childhood did you have?" And I said, "I had a great childhood." He said, "Give me a memory from your childhood." I said, "I got one, baby. Me and Gary Huff." And I tell him all about the Hostess Twinkie or the Ding Dongs or the cupcakes and the Fritos. It's one of my sweetest memories. Matter of fact, the first time I met with the kids at this youth group, I told them about the Hostess cupcakes because it was a great memory from my childhood. And I said, "We need great memories, and Jesus Christ can be the greatest memory you've ever had." So they all knew about my Hostess cupcake addiction and my Fritos and RC Cola. At the revival, the brother preached on this verse. I'd never heard about David's mighty men in my life. I was a kid. I hadn't paid that much attention. What a great verse. And he talked about men standing up for God and standing up for their leadership. And Thursday morning after revival was over, I walked in. The pastor said, "There's three deacons in your office." I thought, "Oh! I should get a cardboard box and get my things together, shouldn't I? Since they want to meet with you right now." I walk in, three guys, one of them who'd been on the committee, called me. Good guys, just going to lay the axe to me. Sitting on the table was a straight big box. I said, "Is that box for me to put my stuff in and leave?" And they said, "David, we've been watching you pretty closely. You're kind of young. You got a lot of things to learn. But we see something special in you. We see the Lord in you. There have been a lot of accusations fired our direction about you and some of the things you've done. But you know what? We haven't found anything wrong with you yet. We haven't found any immoral issues. We haven't found anything that you've done that goes contrary to the Word of God. We think you're the man for this job. And with that, they open up the box. Inside was a box of Hostess cupcakes and a bag of original Fritos and an RC Cola. They said, "We didn't go all the way to Grantsland to get these. We heard that preacher preach about David's mighty men. He longed for something from his childhood, and they loved him so much that they went and got it for him. We love you. And we want you to know that regardless of what comes your way, as long as you're still standing for the Lord, as long as your motives are pure and good and godly, we're going to be your mighty men. We're going to run through the army of the Philistines for you." We're going to put you in the stronghold. And we will not let anyone harm you or hurt you because you're the man of God. Not because of me, but that church exploded. We built a new building within 6 months because we couldn't hold all the people and we didn't build a building big enough. It just began to overflow when God's people stood up. When God's men took a stand, when the men of God were supported, God just fell on that place. I'm honored to be here tonight. I want to see some great things happen this week, and I want to see God's people reach out. I want to see the mighty men and women of this church go out and maybe bring some folks here that they might hear the Word of God, and we're going to be talking about that as we go. But tonight, you know what? I don't mean to put anybody on the spot, but I'm just going to be honest with you. I can't even tell you how many churches I've been in. I don't know how many pastors I've been with. But if you want to put a whole bunch in that very top, I'm glad to put Brother Jack pretty much at the top of my list. I love Brother Jack. And I'm going to tell you why I love him. It's not because of the way he looks. Matter of fact, that kind of put him on the negative side for me right there. I've been privileged to be with him here and then at Cal Allen in Corpus. You don't want to know about Jack Willoughby? He loves his people. I'm going to tell you right now, you will not find anyone who loves you more than Brother Jack. And sometimes we need some mighty men to stand up for us and say, "Hey, we love you too." So here's what I want to do in closing. I've gone past my time. I'm sorry. Oh, and by the way, I have some visitors from Corpus. Y'all got to see them. They're fourth row people. Please meet them tonight. The majority of them are very nice. And I don't know why this was so in my heart, even driving down here yesterday. And y'all are a long ways down here, you know, from anywhere. I mean, y'all are southern part of the South. Southerly part. For some reason, God said, "This is what I want you to do tomorrow night." And I said, "Well, Lord, there'll be a lot of this, but, you know, this is what I'm supposed to do. This is what I was supposed to do." So I just want to do. So here's what I'm going to ask. I want Brother Jack to come to this altar tonight. And I want some mighty men to come and stand with him. Now, if you're not going to stand with him, don't come down here and just put on a show because we don't care about that. I don't know anything about your church. As far as I know, this is the greatest church in the whole world. I'll know better by Wednesday. Ask me then, okay? And maybe this is the most important church in all the world, too. That's great. And Brother Jack and I haven't had a chance to talk. We didn't even get to have lunch today, so I haven't really been able to communicate with him much. But I know how much he loves you, and I know how much he treasures the love that we have for him. So, Brother Jack, I'm just going to ask that you, would you come here and could we have some of our mighty men come and gather around Brother Jack Willoughby right now? And just, I want you to come and put a hand on his shoulder
make your way down. And, I don't agree with everything he does. Well, get over it, okay? He doesn't agree with everything you do either, I guarantee it. Put him in the stronghold tonight. Would you do that? Hey, could we have some mighty women to come down to? Would you all mind doing that? You think I'm leaving you out the whole day, but we know if the prayers are going to get prayed, they're going to be from the women. God bless you ladies for showing up. And I'm just going to ask four or five of you maybe to offer up. We don't have time for long week, but I'm going to ask a few of you just to offer up a prayer for Brother Jack. And then I'll close this out in just a minute, and then we'll be through. But Brother Jack, you need to know other women are coming. There's a lot of ladies who seem to care for you, too. We'll talk about that later, but if some of you offer up a prayer for your pastor, please. I thank you for this night now and for these your people who stand for your servant. Lord, there's some really hard churches out there. This is not the case here. We thank you for your love and for the bringing together of your people. And Lord, would you please just allow us to stand up strong and firm for the pastor and for the staff of this church. And let us, Lord, and fall in love with you all over again and fall in love with them and stand to the point where, regardless of what comes their way, we're here to shield them so that they can continue to do your work. And we thank you for what has gone on in this place. Thank you for what's going to happen, Lord. You're just a mighty God, and we so look forward to how you're going to bring this church up and allow them to share with the lost and dying world. So bless Brother Jack. Thank you for the time that we have together with him. In Jesus' name, amen.